Welcome to Conscious Conversations on KUHSDenver.com, broadcasting worldwide from the Mile High City of Denver, Colorado. It's Sunday night, April 9th, and I'm your host, Stephen Ray Watts. I'm so delighted to be with you last hour Sunday night and all time zones around the world. Sit back and get ready for some uplifting, thought-provoking, and inspiring conversation. As always, plenty of music, and hopefully some spiritual growth over the next 2 hours. Conscious Conversations right here on KUHSDenver.com. Well, I'm very excited to have my guest, Mr. Stephen Latour from Harmony Foundation, in studio with me this evening. But I always like to start off the night with prayer. Feel like we are covered when we do that. Our Heavenly Father, we humbly ask that you bring us together from all over the world for the next 2 hours. United as one collective heart and soul, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And then also there's this prayer that I found a couple weeks ago with Pastor Tim Spikestra in the house. Abba, Father, I pray for the gift of your Holy Spirit to be my guide on this journey to the heart. May he reveal to me the power of your Son, Jesus Christ, and liberate me from the bondage of sin. May he empower me and equip me with the mind of Jesus Christ so that I can love you with my whole being and live a life of love and forgiveness to my neighbors around me. Father, I am aware of my powerlessness and the great need to be directed by your Spirit. Now I surrender and I ask your Spirit to control my life for your glory. Amen.
Amen.
Well, tonight, on Conscious Conversations, I'm very, very excited to have Mr. Stephen Latour with Harmony Foundation right here in studio with me at the beautiful studios of KUHSDenver.com in the Mile High City of Denver, Colorado. We're going to be focusing on recovery from drug and alcohol addiction, and the incredible work that the Harmony Foundation does in the beautiful town of Estes Park. There's one word that comes to mind when we talk about the affliction of drug and alcohol addiction: substance abuse disorder. That's a hard one I've been trying to get used to saying. And the one word is solution. And that's what Stephen and I were talking before the show. We decided, let's talk about the solution. Let's make sure that we make that a big part of this show. So that's what we're planning on doing tonight. We've got music for those of you listening to the radio feed tonight, and a great show. We're going to talk about all kinds of things, but focus on the solution. So sit back. We've got a great show for you tonight. I'm going to read a scripture that I'd like to start out the show with. Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in his presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. And that's John 20, verses 24 through 31. Welcome to Conscious Conversations World. Welcome, everyone. We're going to be talking the solution, talking recovery, on KUHSDenver.com tonight. And welcome to Conscious Conversations on Sunday night, April 9th, 2017. And I'm your host, Mr. Stephen Ray Watts. I've got another Stephen in studio with me tonight. I'm so excited to have Head of Business Development, Mr. Stephen Latour for Harmony Foundation, Inc. And I can only say once again how grateful I am and privileged and honored that I get to have this fellowship with this unbelievable organization that is doing such incredible things with people and their addictions, helping them find sobriety, helping them find spiritual fitness, and helping them find recovery. We'd like to welcome our listeners in from Trabuco Canyon, United States, Thailand, Tokyo, also Anchorage, Alaska, Lima is in the house, France, listening, Malaysia, Irvine, California, Taipei, Taiwan. Welcome to everybody to Conscious Conversations this evening. We've got an unbelievable show for you this evening, and I can't wait to introduce my guest, Stephen Latour. But before we do that, I want to make sure that you stop and try to find our website, which is StephenRayWatts.com. That's Stephen with a PH. And also, I'd love to have you check out my Facebook page, which is facebook.com/StephenRayWatts, and that is Stephen with a PH. Don't forget that you can also go to liveatjax.com. That's liveatjax.com. Live at Jax is one of our sponsors for Conscious Conversations. We're going to kick things off here in just a few minutes. This is Amazing Grace. And after that, we'll be back with Mr. Stephen Latour with Harmony Foundation on Conscious Conversations. Okay, and we're clear from radio. And as I can humbly say to you, I was going like, I know something's wrong. I know I'm doing something not quite right. So I turned up the wrong channel. So I didn't get the opening of the show exactly the way I wanted it for radio. But you know what? I figured it out and got it at least to where I could do an opening segment that was kind of improv. That's the way it goes. But you know what we do here, what we do here on Conscious Conversations is we one of the things that I like to do is give it to the Lord and let the show be exactly what he decides that it needs to be. I'm going to turn up the volume just a little bit, and there we go. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm just delighted to introduce my guest, Stephen Latour. Thank you for coming.
Steve, thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
I'm so excited to have you here. I don't really know where to begin, but I what I'm going to do is try to recover from the early mistake and get my composure back. So, but thank you for coming down to visit with us tonight.
Like I said, I'm definitely glad to be here, regardless if it's Sunday evening.
Well, we're gonna talk recovery.
Excellent. I know a little bit about recovery. I've been sober for a little while. Right.
Yeah, so that's great.
It's one of my favorite topics.
Yeah, me too.
I like staying alive. I like being on this side of the grass.
And being sober is definitely an advantage, if you will, to that, right?
Right, right.
So give us a little bit of background, if you don't mind.
Oh, boy. You know, last time I spoke at an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, you know, they gave me 15 minutes. I said, well, I'm 44 years old, and I was drinking and drugging for probably almost 30 years of that, and I really couldn't squeeze it in. So there was panic involved and whatnot. But the long and short of it, I guess, is that, you know, I was always told to back up a little bit. I was always told when I wanted to give a little background, at least on myself and on recovery, that I need to speak about what it was like, what happened, and then what it's like now.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm a New England native, Massachusetts. You know, I had a really great upbringing. I had great parents. You know, and I was just a young man that was uncomfortable in his own skin. Like many alcoholics or many people in recovery or addicted to drugs will tell you that they just didn't feel like they fit in regardless of their surroundings. Regardless of all the things they might have had or not had, I was not comfortable in my own skin, and I found peace in alcohol. And when the alcohol didn't work, I sought out more drugs. I kept, you know, and it was just a downward spiral to a bottom, you know. Mm-hmm. And luckily through some powerful people that I've met at Alcoholics Anonymous, I was able to find a power greater than myself, and through the gift of desperation, dig myself out of that hole. And I'm here today.
Wow. That's, I mean, and that's a story that, you know, I can relate to, certainly, and realize that, you know, once you cross that line of being beyond human, you know, beyond human aid this way, you need those people to help.
Right. And that was tough for me. You know, I mean, I think that they say that part of being alcoholic is being self-centered, self-absorbed, and everything revolves around self. So seeking out something greater than me, whether it's another person asking for help, it wasn't second nature. You know what I mean?
Right.
I was the all-powerful one. You know what I mean? And whatever powerlessness and unmanageability that crept into my life was not because of me. It's because of everybody else.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, I mean, it was a tough lesson to learn, but enlightening all the same.
Now, this was this mainly while you were in, on the East Coast or?
So, my first treatment center was back in the 2000, I believe, and that was on the East Coast. I was in Vermont. You know, I had done some geographical changes. I went to high school in South Shore, Massachusetts. Went to college outside of Boston. Dropped out of college due to drinking and drugs and poor grades. Academic probation. You know, that's when the powerlessness started coming to me.
You know, and it's college.
Right.
I mean, it's all. We've almost gotten to this point where you're almost expected to have that. It's the party culture. You know.
Right. You know, my parents wanted what was best for me. They wanted me to go to this particular school and follow this particular line in life. You know what I mean? Just because they wanted what's best for me or what they thought. There really wasn't any conversations about what Steve might have wanted. but regardless, I followed that path. But yeah, it was college and it was partying. And I was a year younger than everybody else. I was a freshman in college at 17.
Wow.
First time really away from family. So it was game on for me. Just open the faucet and let it go. And I was always the, you know, I was that guy, you know, at the parties that was too drunk or that was causing too much trouble, that everybody would whisper behind this, you know,
yeah,
was that guy.
Yeah.
That was me. That was me. You know, but was there help back then? You know what I mean? I don't remember the nursing, you know, having alcohol poisoning a couple times, being in the doctor's office or in the nurse's station at the university multiple times, or locked up in the drunk tank. There was never the hand of AA. There was never any guidance counselor that said, hey, maybe you should speak to these people. They basically just said, toughen up, Steve. Go back to class.
Right.
Would I have taken that help? Probably not. But I just remember back in, this was 1989, 1990, it just wasn't there.
Yeah.
There wasn't, you know, any AA literature in the guidance council office or anything like that.
Right.
It was nothing.
Well, and you know, you didn't see the late night commercials
No.
You know, or even really necessarily hear about, you know, the beautiful people going to the, you know, the recovery centers, that whether they were, you know, these beautiful spas or, you know, some celebrity recovery facilities.
Well, there was a stigma still, and there still is today, that is one of the battles that we try to fight. You know, working in business development is trying to battle the stigma of what treatment is, or what we called back then rehab was.
Right.
Rehab back then was, you couldn't handle your alcohol, you're going to rehab. And not only you're going to rehab because you can't handle your alcohol, but you're going to be cured when you go there. That's why you go. There was no message of, this is a lifelong process of growth in spiritual anything. This is, you're going to rehab, they're going to fix you, and you're going to learn how to drink like a normal person when you get out. And it was I'm not an alcoholic because I don't have long hair and a trench coat, drinking out of a paper bag, sleeping in a gutter under a bridge.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
exactly.
I don't have a problem. I'm from South Shore, Massachusetts. You know, I'm kind of a preppy kind of guy, and I don't have a problem. You know what I mean? That kind of thing.
Right. Well, I'm going to probably have you, do a little bit of that, go through this, a little bit of this all over again. When we get ready, we're going to go into radio here. We got about 3 minutes because we got a minute here. And we got two commercials coming up. I'm trying to learn how to talk through the commercials and keep ourselves going. So when we jump right in, we're right into a segment. But it's you're right. And I hadn't even really thought about that. That, you know, it becomes when you get into a community support group and you find that fellowship and you see it on TV and you see... you become part of the recovery community. Uh-huh. You kind of take that as a way of life, and you don't really think back about when it wasn't there,
right,
for people. You know,
right. Yeah, and I think that it not only was it not there for people, but I don't think that families and your community wanted to admit that there was a problem. So they didn't want to. You didn't want to go because you didn't think it was for you. There was a stigma attached there, but your family didn't want you to go because they didn't want to be the family in the neighborhood, right, or the problem person.
Right. Well, you know, I can relate to that. I mean, bless my dad's heart. I lost my dad a year and a half ago, and you know, I mean, he was old school, you know, and when I did my amends and I talked to my dad, my father told my dad, you know, I've got a problem. I'm an alcoholic, you know. And it was the age of, well, you know, let's keep it hush hush, you know. And though, although deep down I know he supported me, you know, taking care of, trying to get better. But, well, we're gonna go live, and we got about 1 minute, and then we'll jump right in, and we'll take it from there. I'll introduce you on the radio. You will be live. Your mic will be live this time, okay, Stephen?
Sure.
All right, here we go. This is gonna be nice. Okay, we're going live. We'll be live right now.
So you think you might have an issue or a problem with alcohol or chemical dependency from drinking or using common denominators?
Just talk as close as you feel comfortable.
As social drinking may directly affect individuals and their workflow. If so, don't wait. Please seek help now. Maybe it's a loved one, friend, co-worker, or associate that you've noticed struggling with that. Someone you care about deeper and doesn't have help or address the issue, but don't want to just sit and watch them spiral into self-destruction. I encourage you to listen to Conscious Conversations hosted by me, Stephen Ray Watts, every Sunday night, 10 p.m. Mountain Standard Time at kuhsdenver.com, where we bring substance use disorder out in the open for honest and compassionate dialogue. In conscious conversations, our mission is recovery, spiritual growth, and solutions to addictions of all types. Join us on our path to peace and freedom from cancer and addiction. In conscious conversations, right here on UHFDenver.com. And here on Mountain Standard Time, we broadcast.
And we welcome you to KUHSDenver.com on Conscious Conversations. This is Stephen Ray Watts, and it is Sunday night, April 9th, 2017. I'd like to start off this segment before I introduce my special guest, Mr. Stephen Latour, with a quick devotion. This is from Jesus Always by Sarah Young. And for those of you that are not familiar, remember, this is as if Jesus were speaking. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. I spoke this truth to Martha when her brother Lazarus had died, and she believed me. Shortly thereafter, I commanded Lazarus to come out of his tomb, and he did, even though he eventually died again, as all believers will. Shortly before my crucifixion, I taught my disciples, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am everything you possibly need for this life and the next. I am the treasure that encompasses all treasures. This truth can simplify your life immensely. I am the answer to all your struggles, the joy that pervades all time and circumstances. I can make hard times bearable and good times utterly delightful. So come to me just as you are, beloved. Share more and more of your life with me. Rejoice as you journey with me, the way who guides you always, and the resurrection who gives you eternal life. And that is a devotion based on Scripture, John 11, 25 and 43 through 44, John 14, chapter 6, verse 6, Colossians 2, verses 2 and 3, and Matthew 11, 28. Well, I'm in studio with Mr. Stephen Latour he's in the business developer for Harmony Foundation up in Estes Park. Welcome, Stephen.
Glad to be here, Steve. Thanks for having me.
I'm so delighted to have you with us this evening. It is a privilege and a pleasure. It's one of those things that I feel so much gratitude for what Harmony has given Conscious Conversations. Wendy Stein was here, numerous guests. I got to go up and do one of the Saturday night speaker series, and just don't have anything else to say, but I've witnessed firsthand what Harmony has done.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I couldn't be happier to be part of that organization. And it was a no-brainer, like I mentioned earlier in our conversation, when a job opportunity opened up there when I was living in South Florida, kind of not on a dead-end road, but needed a change, and I had close personal friends and relationships with people at the Harmony Foundation, and I could not get out here fast enough.
So it's one of those things where this, you were telling me earlier that this, getting into this as a profession is kind of a push me pull you, I would think, because when you've been given the unbelievable gift of sobriety, you want to give back. But at the same time, there's realities there, and bringing it into a vocation, it's a little bit like the music business from the standpoint of it's, you have a passion for it, but then there's realities that go with it.
So there is a golden rule for anybody who is in recovery and works in the substance use disorder field. And that is that your job is not your recovery.
Ah.
So your recovery, my recovery, is completely separate from my work at the Harmony Foundation. So you could argue that, okay, my work at the Harmony Foundation and the Business Development Department, which would be educating the public and meeting with other professionals and about what Harmony offers and you know, getting the people the help that they need, is work. My recovery is in Alcoholics Anonymous and helping people go through the 12 steps for their recovery and in turn for me to stay sober.
You know, I'm so happy that you said that, because, you know, that would be confusing for people. And if you kind of the in between of that would be counseling, but the fact of the matter is you have to take care of your recovery first.
100%. 100%. You know, and I'm sure it's across the board in most professions that there is a level of getting burned out. You know, and when you're dealing with a sick and suffering and a population just reaching out can be taxing.
Yeah.
I'm sure we see a number of people seeking help coming through the rooms of AA, but when you're dealing with families or even some private professionals that are working with families and you're in the middle of that and you're trying to get people the help that they need, you got to be able to let go of that. You have to be able to go to sleep at night. You have to be able to say, this is work. Let Harmony Foundation do what Harmony Foundation does. I need to get to a meeting and take care of Steve today.
That shows a really, you know, a basic understanding of, look, you know, when I first got sober, you know, they told me, you've got to make this number one. This is your priority. And I said, well, I'm, you know, and even to the point of some of them said, this is your priority above God, above family, above anything. I go, no, wait a minute now, you know, and then, but I can realize, you know, to thine own self be true. And that idea, and then bringing in the idea of that it's God, it's the sobriety. And I had a closed mouth friend that I was working with. And after I had done some step work, he said, what are the deal breakers? You know? And I said, well,
that's a tough question.
Yeah. And I came up with a couple of, which was like, if I were to lose a child, if my wife were to divorce me, you know, things like this. And the first thing he said, well, the good news is there are no deal breakers, because you've just mentioned things that are you have no control over. They're not yours. They're God's. And I thought, wow. And I could really grab onto that, Steve.
I mean, I remember, I think my sponsor put it as, what are your reservations?
Oh.
Do you have any reservations? And common in the rooms, especially with some of the younger people seeking recovery, the number one reservation was always, well, if I win the lottery. Well, if I win the lottery. Well, if you win the lottery, you're going to prolong your misery for, you know, hopefully it'll be over quickly. But, you know, so luckily, you know, through step work, I have no reservations. My sobriety has to come first.
Yeah.
And it was common for me to hear, you know, whatever you put in front of your sobriety, you're going to lose. And it took a while to figure out exactly what they meant. So I had to go out and test it myself.
Yeah.
So you put work in front of your recovery, you lose your job. You put a relationship in front of your recovery, you're going to lose that relationship. You know, and you turn in, I learned the hard way. I was the person that had to touch the hot stove myself. So
yeah.
I lost my sobriety more than once.
Okay. Well, you know, that I appreciate you sharing that, because that's something that people need to hear. And you know what? I needed to hear that, because I did too.
Right.
And it's the craziest thing. It seems to be that is a fact for some people. There are some people that find that sobriety and they're off and running, and they can it clicks right away. It wasn't that way for me. Of course, I didn't have the support group the first time. And then once I found that the second time, I knew I was on my last chance, as it were, Steve. Because I was 47 years old mm-hmm. at the time. So it's time.
Mm.
So
I had a support group. I was sober for a few years, my first go around, and I drifted from the herd, so to mm-hmm. speak. So I had a great support group, great friends in sobriety, got into a relationship, and that relationship slowly pushed my program, or I allowed it to, out of the way. So it was it wasn't sudden. It was over the span of almost 2 years for me to separate myself from that word before I fell. And so first on the list every day now is stay in the center of the herd.
Yeah.
I need to stay connected. I have to, because my life depends on it. And the people that my sponsees, other people, you know what I mean? We're connected. We rely on each other.
Yeah.
So it's not just always just about Steve today.
Yeah. And that fellowship is, you know, it goes back to, I consider it one of the big things in sobriety. Would you?
Oh, absolutely. Yep. Yep. Recovery Unity Service. I owe most of my sobriety, and I owe this go around anyway, to the fellowship, 100%.
Yeah.
And that's why I found it so necessary to really find people and most importantly, find a power greater than myself that I believe in, and other people that believe the same. So we could walk the journey together, and we could lean on each other. Without that fellowship, it's just an hour out of my day.
In
a meeting, I need to, you know, we go out for coffee in the before my home group. I speak to other alcoholics that I'm not friends with daily. You know what I mean? Just to reach out, just to have another voice, just to check on each other, and it's a beautiful thing. You know,
and it's like we talk about in the rooms. We talk about, you know, these are people that wouldn't normally, you know, hang out together, but we have this bond of wanting to help each other stay sober and stay spiritually fit, and that's the bond. That's the fellowship. That brings me back to our devotion, where, you know, the disciples back in the day, I mean, that was the fellowship, and the fellowship was beginning. And, you know, I find that whenever you do something and you have a purpose together, there's power in that. And especially if it's a positive, positive energy and a positive purpose, and sobriety is definitely that.
I agree 100%. You know, it's a new skill set for me as an alcoholic, for me to learn how to ask for help, and have other eyes on my problem and other ears listening before I made a big decision. That was always one of the first things I learned was, okay, you know, call your sponsor every day, go to a meeting every day, and make sure you call another alcoholic if you have a big decision. And that just became habit. You know, a lot of, I spent a lot of time living in a sober living halfway house, almost 2 years. And what that taught me was, it got me into the habit of being in recovery. They put rules that I had to follow. That would I have followed them outside of a sober living? Maybe. But it was, you know, you do this or you live under the bridge. It was like,
right,
this is the end of the road. So you need to go to a meeting every day. You need to follow these rules. And part of those rules were to reach out, to ask for help, to have a sponsor, to go through the steps, and to build a fellowship. And, you know, eventually it becomes second nature and your life starts to improve.
Right. It's a discipline at the beginning.
Right.
And then becomes habit through repetition and through seeing others do the same thing.
And the trick there, and as it becomes habit, is to make sure that you're keeping complacency at a distance, and you don't end up, the habit becomes so comfortable that you, what do they say, rest on your laurels.
Yes. Well, and that you bring up so many incredible points that I want to ask you. I mean, I want to ask you, you know, just the whole, the stigma of rehab, we need to talk about that. So when we remind me of that, and then I'm writing these things down. Also, you know, why is it so hard for some person to say, I'm an alcoholic or I'm a drug addict, and surrender to that powerlessness? And then also, you know, again, another thing is meetings. These support group meetings, I hear it every single day. I stop going to meetings. When we come back on Conscious Conversations, we're going to explore all these things. But right now, Amanda Cook with Mercy. I love this song on KUHSDenver.com. Okay, and we're clear from radio. And yeah, these are things that I love what we've got going here, Steve, is I'm really excited from the standpoint of we're bringing the honesty of what we do on a daily basis and what is important to us to a new level here. That, you know, I've always kind of had I dance around the anonymity thing, you know, with people. But at the same time, I always talk about, well, wait a minute now. I'm going to just say it. Look, Alcoholics Anonymous is such a huge part of why I'm sober today. Mm-hmm. Why not just, but I know the idea. I understand the idea is that that tradition is that what happens if, say, I stop going to meetings, say I stop following the principles of the program and working the 12 steps, and then I fall, and then somebody says, okay, see, AA doesn't work. Mm-hmm. So I get that. But at the same time, there's people out there that need it, and we need to get it to them. We need to be able to shout it out.
It's such a fine line.
Yes.
The anonymity. And I surround myself with a lot of people in recovery these days, whether it's just because it's my job and, you know, I have some really good friends in the program.
Mm-hmm.
But a grand sponsor of mine in South Florida, Jimmy, you know, Jimmy says, you know, you can't have some of the conversations that we have as men in recovery with each other with normal people, because mm-hmm. they'd probably lock you up.
Right.
You know, because, you know, we talk about some things that men normally don't talk about with each other normally, or at least because of whatever social boundaries of social acceptance for men, mm-hmm. whatever the case is. I mean, you can't talk, you don't talk to the person behind you in the grocery line about, well, I had a dream about smoking crack last night. You know what I mean? And that's normal to them. And
yeah.
They'll, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But you can talk, it's just that thing that I think is part of the anonymity. We this is for us.
Right. Yeah. And I get that. And yet there are so many people, you know, I feel I have some friends that are very close, that one friend who's a brilliant guy owns a number of patents, a beautiful wife and two beautiful daughters, and AA was not for him, and his solution was to go put a bullet in his head.
Mm.
And that's real.
I know that dark place personally. I spent a couple times in a lockdown inpatient psych. My first suicide attempt, I was 28 years old.
Mm.
28 years old. I had lost my mother a few years before that to breast cancer. And my drug habit at that time was fairly severe.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in that dark place. So
yeah.
When people talk about, they talk about suicide is very common and amongst alcoholics and drug addicts.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's the darkest place. It's the darkest place. And, you know, I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy. It's just a horrible place. And it's, I wish that there was a magic something that, you know, outside. So I guess it goes back to what we were talking about before is why can't everybody climb out of the, admit that they're powerless over alcohol, seek help and surrender.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And unfortunately some of us can't. And that's why they said alcoholism is fatal.
Yes.
It's fatal.
Yes. You know, it's the idea of blotting out the intolerable, you know, existence of our consciousness now. And I know I'm not, you know, I'm paraphrasing a part of the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, but, or seek help. And, you know, it's, and some people can seek help and some people are, unfortunately, that's the reality of addiction in many cases is death. It's very real.
So, I mean, a lot of people don't, you don't see that there's a solution. I mean, the darkness, it blinds you.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, solace is death. I mean, that's the goal.
Right.
And sometimes there's just the light is just not going to be turned on. It's just not going to happen. So I also, outside of business development for the Harmony Foundation, on the board of directors with the Suicide Prevention Coalition of Colorado.
Oh, wow.
Which is the SPCC.
Mm-hmm.
And I got invited to apply to be on their board of directors, and I've never been on a board of anything before, so uh-huh. it was an honor.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there's some fear involved there. You know
sure.
what I mean? But it's a small nonprofit group that really does some great work here in Colorado. But it's been a passion of mine trying to bring the substance abuse and alcoholism conversation into the suicide prevention world, because the two don't speak to each other, which was mind blowing to me.
Yeah.
You would think that to throw numbers out there, there's 4 out of 5 suicides in Colorado are men, which is
wow.
which is fairly disproportionate in my eyes.
Yes, yes.
But over almost 3/4 of them, there's alcohol present.
Oh,
but
man.
But the suicide prevention people they're not well-versed in seeking help for substance abuse and alcoholism. So it's kind of strange. You would think that they would know a lot about seeking treatment for people in alcoholism in the suicide prevention world, but it's just not there.
Well, but how perceptive of you to see that need, you know? And I'm going to close this door so we don't get this delay we're getting here real quick, Steve. You know, to see that need and bring that into the forefront.
It was kind of one of those aha moments, or I was at a men's health forum, and actually Wendy assigned me to attend this men's health forum and bring the message of Harmony. We had a booth and the whole business development thing. And I really had no idea what the men's health forum was going to be about.
Mm-hmm.
So I figured there was going to be quite a few different substance abuse treatment facilities.
There. Yeah.
And Harmony was... Maybe there was another one. Maybe West Pines was there, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I was just kind of blown away that this huge suicide prevention men's health forum had very little to zero substance abuse representation. And it just kind of clicked. Being a suicide attempt survivor, mm-hmm. knowing that dark place, being an alcoholic in recovery, I said, I need to talk about this
yeah.
and see what I can do to have these two sides of two organizations or two paths cross.
Well, and with the idea that having experienced the darkness of that side of having a suicide attempt, and then also with the substance use disorder, you know, you have the experience to bring that together and say, hey, look, this is a need of ours. Let's address this.
Yeah, and you know it's they focus a lot on mental health and in the suicide prevention world, rightfully so, but very rarely do you hear the conversation. Well, was there alcohol or drugs involved? And I still think that there's some stigma there.
Yeah,
I think that a lot of families and whatnot are already distraught enough that there's been some suicide attempts or suicidal thoughts. To start labeling as alcoholic and drug addict would just be the icing on the cake, and they don't want to touch it. You know, they want to focus on the mental
right.
health because it sounds better.
Right.
No, my son's not a drug addict. He just has mental health problems.
Wow.
And so that's part of the stigma. Is
yeah.
people will not seek help. They don't want to be the family on the block.
Right.
You know, I remember in my suburb of Boston and in Massachusetts, you know, when we'd have our family dinners, our family ate dinner every night together. And, you know, when it was warm enough out, the windows were open in our neighborhood. And if you heard a family arguing, you know, they were the crazy family in the neighborhood.
yeah.
And we didn't want to be that crazy family. So everything was hush hush.
Yeah. You know? Well, and, you know, we're 10 years difference in age. And yet, I remember, you know, when we had family dinners too, and I remember now that's just between these four walls,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's, and that's the other thing is that we didn't, I had a great relationship with parents too, and so no one's immune
mm-hmm.
to subject to alcoholism or drug addiction.
So my mother was. What they, I guess they call a functioning alcoholic.
Uh-huh.
You know, and it before she died, it progressed into carrying her upstairs to bed every day. But it was never discussed as a problem. She got up. She was very successful at what she did. She worked. We went skiing. She took us camping, hiking, and fishing. But she would drink herself to a blackout every night. But it wasn't a problem. You know, my friends would come over as teenagers, and my mother would be a little loopy, and it was fun to hang out with my mom. You know, she'd be on the phone talking to her cousins for hours, just drunk, you know, and it was interesting that it was just not spoken about in the family.
Yeah.
It just wasn't.
Yeah.
I mean, there were some comments here or there that I made as a young man that didn't really go over well, but the conversation never went further than me making a comment.
Yeah,
that's about it.
Well, I tell you, it's one of those things that, you know. How do we find? We're talking solution. The solution. How do we get? It's we got to get over the stigma of what we're talking about here. Let people go. What makes it so hard for somebody to say, okay, to surrender and say, I'm an alcoholic? Because, I mean, you get to that place.
It's the million-dollar question.
Yeah. And, you know, yeah. I remember when the first meeting I walked into, I was still shaking.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a spiritual foundation, a faith in God, that I had some, after I'd left West Pines treatment center, I still had some delirium tremens to go through.
Mm-hmm.
And they were quite benign. They were real, but they weren't the horrific things I've heard about with some people. I saw some weird things here and there, and they were almost comical, but I was in a safe place. I was
right.
Home, and I had a good relationship with God, and my wife was helping me. Early sobriety was not easy. Don't get me wrong, but when I walked in that meeting, I'm an alcoholic, no problem.
So you're lucky.
Yeah.
You're lucky. A lot of people don't want to admit that there's a problem. So
you can just see it.
In the first step, admitting their power is over alcohol, and then my life has become unmanageable. I think it's the unmanageability. I think that people start to say, okay, there might be a problem. I'm not going to admit it yet, but I'm unable to stop on my own. I've tried numerous times. And also, outside of trying numerous times to stop on my own, I've tried to stop for other people. I've tried to stop for my wife or my spouse. I've tried to stop so I could keep my job. And I think after countless times of realizing that you can't stop when you get the DTs or whatever substance you're addicted to, the withdrawals can be overwhelming.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're going to seek help. But it's only because... It's not because you have a problem. It's because you just don't feel well. You know what I mean? So I think once you lose your job, you can't pay the rent or you can't pay the mortgage anymore, and the wife leaves and your kids won't speak to you anymore, and you're sleeping on the gutter, that level of unmanageability is pretty motivating.
Yes.
To say, okay, I better seek help. So instead of, you know, luckily there's the rooms of AA that you can walk into that nobody knows you're walking into.
Mm-hmm.
Going to treatment is another...
Yeah,
it's another whole. Everybody knows you're going to treatment because
yeah.
It's expensive. You're worried about your insurance, knowing that you might have a problem. The anonymity is out the window if you're going to treatment. Everybody
right.
in your family knows. They're usually surrounding you with love and trying to help you.
Yeah, or the intervention, right? Yeah.
And so luckily there's AA
yeah.
or NA where you can walk into and at least sit and listen.
Mm-hmm.
You know. I'm trying to remember if I remember correctly the first time I introduced myself as an alcoholic.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I had any problem. It was obvious.
It
was obvious. And I really don't think I really cared what other people thought.
Well, and the diversity of people and their problem of addiction is as well as diverse as people are in general. I mean, people have their own personality, and so. One person's bottom is not the other person's bottom.
Right.
And some people come in, you know, and thinking like, I heard a gentleman share the other day. He says, you know, I don't think I'm an alcoholic, but I just can't imagine a day going by without having drinks. And it got me to thinking. And so, you know, it really is a diverse idea of what gets the mind working in that situation. Yeah. You know, I think about, you know, and I'm probably going to repeat a little bit of this on radio, but, you know, when you have a song by Amy Winehouse about not wanting to go to rehab, and
doesn't help the mission.
No, I mean, it's just like, you know, you've got this big star, and she's refusing to go to rehab, even though she knows she needs it. And yet, at the same time, it ended up very badly.
Yeah, it did. You know?
And
it was horrific.
Yeah, and it's sad, and what a waste, what a waste. When we get back on, we're gonna do. Let's see, we're gonna do another radio segment here, and then we're gonna do. So I want to talk about a couple of things, but I want to. Stay in the solution. Let's talk about, you know, how I want to talk about things like what harmony does. I want to talk about, you know, is the alcohol as opposed to drugs. I have a burning question. I want to get your opinion on has legalized marijuana had an impact on what you guys do up there?
Do you want to save that for the radio?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we're not very far. We're just about a minute away, and then I'm going to do one more short devotion, and then we'll jump right on in. So, and I'll turn up the right mics. We've got.
There's so much going on those screens. I'm a gamer. I play online.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, I play online video games, mostly war games with some friends all around the country. Yeah. And there's.
Oh, I'm telling you, this. Have you seen the. You've seen that there's a thing on TV where they pull these things over there and they're flying these drones through these.
Oh yeah, they're drone race. Yeah, they're racing drones. There's a term for it, but I looked into that. It's really neat.
Oh my gosh, it's cool.
They go through the forest, they have race courses.
I know. Well, on Conscious Conversations, I'm so thrilled to have Mr. Stephen Latour with me.
Thank you,
tonight. We're gonna be doing. What I do usually is I talk while the commercial's on, and then so I can flip it right around. So, but thank you.
You're welcome.
You're helping me. And I also want to talk about, you know, the spiritual part of it and kind of personally your spiritual fit, ideas and fitness.
Okay.
So, we're going live. And you're listening to Conscious Conversations on KUHSDenver.com. I've got a short devotion that I'd like to start this next segment out with. And I hope it's a short one, but it's a good one. This is from Streams in the Desert. And those of you that listen to Conscious Conversations, you know that I love these devotions. It's a way for me to get the Word of God out to the whole world, God's living Word. But also put out these devotions of people's experiences from all over the world, including places that are listening in right now. And that is Thailand, Sydney, Australia. And I say this every week. I'm getting really excited about Sydney coming in every week because I am someday going to play at that opera house. That's been a dream of mine since I've been 13. And Cary, United States, Los Angeles is listening. Tokyo, Japan, Bangladesh. Manila, the Philippines, Allentown, United States, China is logged in, Cambodia, Vietnam, Hanoi, Vietnam, and also Germany. Welcome everybody to Conscious Conversations tonight with my special guest, Mr. Stephen Latour from Harmony Foundation Rehabilitation Facility. This is a devotion from Streams in the Desert by Mrs. Charles E. Kalman. Their strength is to sit still. That is the scripture, and that's from Isaiah 30, verse 7. In order really to know God, inward stillness is absolutely necessary. I remember when I first learned this, a time of great emergency had risen in my life, when every part of my being seemed to throb with anxiety. and when the necessity for immediate and vigorous action seemed overpowering. And yet circumstances were such that I could do nothing, and the person who could would not stir. For a little while, it seemed as if I must fly to pieces with the inward turmoil, when suddenly the still, small voice whispered in the depths of my soul, "Be still and know that I am God." The word was with power, and I hearkened. I composed my body to perfect stillness, and I constrained my troubled spirit into quietness, and looked up and waited. And then I did know that it was God, God even in the very emergency and in the helplessness to meet it. And I rested in him. It was an experience that I would not have missed for worlds. I may add also that out of this stillness seemed to arise a power to deal with the emergency. That very soon brought it to a successful issue. I learned then effectually that my strength was to sit still. And that was a devotion by Hannah Whitall Smith. There's more. There's a perfect passivity which is not of indolence. I had to look up these words, by the way. There's a perfect passivity which is not indolence. It is a living stillness born of trust. Quiet tension is not trust. It's simply compressed anxiety. I understand that. I relate to that. And I can't resist this. I know I'm running a little long with this devotion, but this is something I want everyone to hear, because this is a beautiful, beautiful poem. Not in the tumult of the rending storm, not in the earthquake or devouring flame, but in the hush that could all fear transform, the still, small whisper to the prophet came. O soul, keep silence on the mount of God. Though cares and needs throb around thee like a sea, from supplications and desires unshod, be still and hear what God shall say to thee. All fellowship has interludes of rest, new strength maturing in each poise of power. The sweetest alleluias of the blessed are silent for the space of half an hour. O rest in utter quietude of soul. Abandon words, leave prayer and praise a while. Let thy whole being hushed in his control, learn the full meaning of his voice and smile. Not as an athlete wrestling for a crown, not taking heaven by violence of will, but with thy father as a child sit down and know the bliss that follows his "Be Still." And that's from Mary Rolls Jarvis. That's just a devotion I couldn't resist to bring to you this evening. And it's from Streams in the Desert by Mrs. Charles Kalman. I'm with Stephen Latour, and we are talking recovery. We're talking solution. We're also talking about an incredible place in Estes Park, Colorado, called Harmony Foundation, that Stephen began working at a little over a year ago, right, Steve?
Yeah, coming up on a year and a half now.
That's fantastic. And you kind of, I'm going to have you go through your background just a little bit. Tell us how you got to Harmony. From the East Coast.
From the East Coast.
And the South.
Right. From the Southeast Coast, more specifically. I worked for a sober living in Delray Beach, Florida, called Sober Living in Delray, for a few years. And Harmony Foundation consistently referred clients to us to begin their journey in recovery in Delray Beach. Delray Beach is kind of a destination recovery spot. It's almost hip to be in recovery down there, especially for younger people, because there's just so many people. It has a huge population of people in recovery. AA, NA meetings around the clock, 400 meetings a week within a 10 square mile area down there. So recovery is kind of on everybody's lips around town. But Harmony, over, God, had to be 12 to 15 years, have been sending clients to us. So I got to see and know the true Harmony Foundation. When you actually get to meet and work with clients coming out of a substance abuse treatment facility, you really get to know the work that they do personally. And you get to know their staff, mm-hmm. not only from primary counselor, but all the way up through discharge planning and their nursing and whatnot. So when a position opened up in beautiful Estes Park to work for a nonprofit substance abuse facility that I knew did the real work, that provided that spiritual reset that is so necessary for people seeking recovery, it was a no-brainer. To move to the Rockies, yes, please.
So, yeah.
So I have a long history with them, even though I've only been employed with them for about a year and a half or so.
Yeah. And is it a place that you feel that you've set down some roots and feel like you'll be at for a while?
So my younger sister will always refer to me as a nomad. I have, and I think a lot of that has to do with the alcoholic lifestyle.
Yeah.
Always running for myself, grew up in Massachusetts to Vermont, to North Carolina, to South Florida, to Colorado a couple times. I lived overseas in Barcelona, Spain for 6 months. I've been around the block.
Wow.
And it was very hard for me to, pound the tent stakes in. And I think I have found that for sure.
Wow, I'm very happy to hear you say that. It is a beautiful place to live. Although it has changed. We're talking about the state of Colorado here in the United States, and specifically in the Front Range part. But all of Colorado is absolutely beautiful. It brings me to it seems like a segue to me, but it's that's just my strange mind. The whole legalized marijuana issue, and how have you seen in your experience with it here? Has there been more people coming to Harmony or with an idea? Because there's so many people that say, "Oh, that's not addictive."
So we have not seen an uptick in admissions related to the legalization of marijuana. That's not to say that it has not put people in situations where they need to seek medical help. So just from the professionals that I speak with and some lectures that I've attended on this very issue, it's been emergency room visits due to the higher potency of the marijuana and the edibles and whatnot. There has been an uptick, but not noticeable. So if you were to look at it overall for the year or for quarterly, it's almost non-existent for those seeking treatment.
Right.
It's more emergency room visits.
Wow.
So people that come into in seeking treatment, there's usually marijuana is there, but it's not primary.
Ah.
So it would be alcohol, cocaine, opiates, benzodiazepines like Valium or Xanax or something like that. But not primary marijuana.
And with that, do you, within detox and programming a 30-day stay at Harmony, you require complete abstinence, correct?
We are an abstinence-based program. So this will be our 48th year. So back in 1969, a fellow by the name of Bob Dean acquired that property in Estes Park and decided to turn it into a Minnesota model drug and alcohol treatment facility, abstinence-based. So that is in our, whatever a nonprofit would call their rules or bylaws or whatever the term is, it's an abstinence-based facility. Abstinence is always the goal, and we focus heavily on the 12 steps.
Mm-hmm. And I have had the opportunity... and I say opportunity, that the great honor and privilege to have had the opportunity to go up and speak at the Saturday night speaker meeting. And one of the things I found so it was wonderful. Just, you know, the diversity of people, but also, you know, the age differential. It was amazing to me, and yet it was very, very. I didn't expect it to be so 12-step heavy, and it was refreshing.
So I got to, I had the luxury of what they call shadowing some of the staff on Harmony's campus, and I got to spend some time with our counseling techs who are in direct contact with the clients throughout their stay and probably have the most contact with them throughout their stay. And I got to witness them and assigning all of the step work and step related work that our clients get throughout their stay. We try. The goal is to get them through a fifth step at Harmony, but of course that depends on the length of stay.
Right.
So, you know, we are based on a 30-day stay, but now with our transitional care program, we can be anywhere from a detox only to 120 days.
Wow.
Yeah. So you can spend 120 days at Harmony.
And that is that all based on? Do they base that a lot on what I'm sure like what insurance will cover and?
So unfortunately, you know, insurance companies dictate length of stay. They base that on medical necessity. So being a 12-step abstinence-based program, over the past few years, we've actually expanded into dealing more with mental health as well. So we are definitely trauma-informed and dual diagnosis friendly. So we are still primary substance abuse, but we are dealing with more mental health issues these days out of necessity. You know, so we're medical necessity is going to get more days approved at if insurance is covering a substance abuse treatment. If there's a stronger mental health component in there, then you're going to get more days as well. I would assume. So we're basing ourselves on a 30-day program. If you're going to stay for aftercare, you can stay for another 3 months to make it 120 days.
Wow. That's fantastic. I'm so happy to hear that, because there are people that need that.
So, you know, the, NATAP, which is the, National Association of Addiction Treatment Providers. I can't believe
you did it, man.
So NATAP just completed a study that covered 750 subjects over a period of time to get some outcomes on treatment and people in recovery. So this is a study that has not. There hasn't been a study this thorough yet. And what they found, without any doubt, is longer treatment is better outcomes. I don't have the exact percentages of sobriety within the first year of a 30-day program or a 60-day program versus a 90-day program, but the more treatment, the better.
Yeah.
The more treatment, the better, especially in the younger folk. You hear a lot of people saying that, you know, you see for young adults, there are some 6-month programs out there. And there are some 12-month programs out there. And they're finding that, like we discussed earlier about getting into the habit of being in recovery,
right,
that the younger people actually see a change no sooner than 6 months, where they actually feel like they're having fun being sober.
Right.
It takes that long.
Yeah, and you have to get that feeling of, oh, I like this. I like this. And you get this feeling of, where it's replacing the high or the feeling of intoxication with getting these feelings of serenity.
Mm-hmm.
I remember a time where I was sitting at the back bar of our music club downtown, and it was during the day, so it was off hours, and I was just sitting there because we were doing something else, and I had a few seconds of unbelievable euphoria, serenity, and this was an early sobriety. And I asked some people at it about at the support group meeting, and they said, "Well, Steve, you just experienced your first little shot of complete serenity. So remember what that felt like, and keep working at it, and you'll get more of those, and they'll be more often." And I was ready.
So there was most of my recovery or my early recovery was seeking something greater than myself. And I can get into that more about my upbringing and was there church involved and was there not church involved. But I came into recovery godless, not believing in anything greater than me, and working with, a close friend named Jason Chemos in South Florida. Asking him about what God was and what I'm supposed to be looking for. What is this spiritual experience people keep speaking of? And he said, "Have you ever sat on your back porch or quietly alone out somewhere outside and just sat there relaxed and had that euphoric feeling. He said, that's God, you dummy. Seriously. And it made sense to me. Because when I finally felt comfortable enough in my own skin to sit by myself and be at peace, he said, this is your first step towards God.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just what you just said.
You know, it's I'm so happy you said that because the way you said it, Steve, you know, I was talking to a dear friend of mine today in the program, and we were discussing, and he's working with a young girl, and it's who's not in the program, and we were talking about one of the greatest assets of the Alcoholics Anonymous program is the idea of, okay, well, I don't believe in God. I don't know how to believe in God. Where do I start? I don't even know where to begin. So I'm not trying to tell you that, I'm not trying to be belligerent about this, but I have no experience. So the greatest asset being, why don't you come up with your own idea of what you think God would be from your own experience? Do you think that is one of the great assets?
If not the biggest asset to keep people engaged. And like my sponsor told me, but just start by believing that I believe. And that's going to open the door up enough. And just making that decision to believe that somebody else believes was the first step for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's huge. You know, either if I had a nickel, Steve, for every time that I heard somebody in the rooms say, well, it's not that I didn't believe in spirituality or believe in a power greater than myself. It's just I didn't think he wanted to have anything to do with me. You know, I've heard that so often. And, you know, I try to tell if people are interested in hearing my point of view, I will say, well, here's my point of view. It's like the idea of the prodigal son. You know, this great loving God it's not that he doesn't want anything to do with you. What it is he's running towards you with his arms wide open. If you just picture that, and then you can begin to see that there is that all, you know, that love. It's just love.
Mm.
You know, so, you know, I think that's an amazing, and I'm so happy you told me that you came into the program, because I've talked to some other people that in the program that came in and thought they were atheists,
mm-hmm.
and stayed in the program, and through working the 12 steps and living this way of life, found their higher power. It took 16 years, and now they've got 30 years, and they're one of the most devout, faithful people I've ever met.
So I grew up in South Shore, Massachusetts. Okay, so my entire class of in high school or just growing up, Irish Catholic, South Boston, about 45 minutes south of Boston. My mother was raised Catholic. My father was raised Southern Baptist. When my mother was going to marry my father, she was told that she could not marry in a Catholic church because he had been divorced.
Right.
She said, well, then I'm done. And she left. She left the Catholic faith.
Mm-hmm.
She said, if my love for this man is not good enough for this church, then there is no God, or I don't believe anymore. And that was the final straw for my mother.
Mm-hmm.
and religion. My father really could take it or leave it. Earlier in my mother's life, her younger brother died of polio, and that was her first step in leaning towards not believing.
Mm. Yeah.
Her little brother was her world.
Yes.
How could God take somebody who was such a fantastic little boy from us? So then the church situation, her marrying my father, was the final straw. So I was raised outside of Boston with no religion whatsoever.
Wow.
Everybody in my neighborhood went to church. Everybody went to Sunday school. Everybody had their first communion, except for myself and my younger sister. So we were the only two in the neighborhood of many children
that
did not attend. So being the troublemaker that I was, so if I was given a choice. I'm not going to say that we weren't allowed to go. I was given a choice.
Right.
So you give a six-year-old, do you want to go build forts and light fires, or do you want to go to Sunday school?
Right.
It's like, no, I don't.
Yeah.
So that snowballed, being a rebel, troublemaker, young man that I was, that snowballed into atheism. I mean, it was, there's nobody in the sky that's going to help me. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I rebelled, you know what I mean? It wasn't that I had any knowledge of belief or non-belief. It was, if I'm going to be this outcast, then I'm going to take this all the way. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that created a lot of friction for me and all of my cousins because they all went to church. So my sister and I were not only outcasts in the neighborhood,
wow,
but in the entire family.
Sure.
Because we were the only kids out of everybody that were not involved with the church at all.
Wow. Well, that's fascinating to me. And to me, it's like, you know, I always say on this show, the greatest gift that my mom and dad gave me was a foundation in faith. And it truly made the process of finding, once I found, sobriety and the 12 steps, it made the whole process easier because I could grasp onto that God that I've always had, but I was always putting something between myself and that God. But it's always been a wonderful, a fascination of mine of how do you tell somebody, how do you get somebody to be open to, and or like you say, open that door just even a crack to where that they can walk in and experience, because when they experience God on them, they find him on their own. Not somebody preaching him, not somebody telling them this is what they should be, but they find it. Then it becomes incredibly strong, incredibly strong. When we come back, we're going to talk some more with Stephen Latour. This has been a unbelievably fascinating conversation. We're going to continue it right after this. We're going to listen to Lost and Found by Dotsero on KUHSDenver.com. Conscious Conversations. We went a little bit longer. I just couldn't stop. I couldn't stop. We were on a roll, bro. That was really, really good. And hearing, so, you know, hearing you speak, you know, that honesty and that, you know, how that came about is just incredible to me.
You know, there's a, I'm sure you've experienced in the rooms when, you know, the conversation always comes up, finding something greater than yourself in the rooms. And you hear a lot of the people that have had, feel like they've been let down in their faith.
Yeah.
Have a hard time believing.
Right.
You know what I mean? Then you have the people that just don't believe in anything. And then you have people like me who came in with nothing to really, nothing to point me in either direction. It's almost like I had a clean slate coming in. Mm-hmm. I didn't think that God abandoned me because I wasn't a believer. I came in, I think, on a different playing field than most. It was easier for me, I think, because I didn't have anything to base anything on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't have any.
It's kind of like a canvas that you can.
Yeah, it was.
You know, start with something and have the time to ponder it for a second and test it.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't have a picture of anything that I had to compare anything to.
Yeah. Well, and the thing is, you know, at the same time, I find the people that bless their hearts in sobriety. We said we're going to talk about solution, okay? And we have been. And to me, one of the solutions is finding that spiritual guide, that higher power that will solve your problems and help you live a life that is not just sober, but joyful and happy, because you can stop the drug and alcohol and be miserable. I've seen it, and it's excruciating to watch, because you know it's just, you feel like it's somebody on the edge of a cliff all the time. And so I want to get your take on that. Like, Have you seen both? Have you seen, you know, the, we call it white knuckling, and
right.
And also, but the spiritual fitness, the living a life of spirituality, is to me a huge part of the solution.
So I think it's everything, and the white knuckling is if your coping skills for life began and ended with alcohol or drugs, and you take those away from a person,
mm-hmm.
then there is an open wound, a hole in your soul, with no coping skills that can only be pain and suffering and unmanageability. You know, I don't think that I would be as happy and grateful and serene as I am today without having completed the 12 steps and passed the message. Some people are content with white knuckling, and they just think, well, you know, I can't drink because I'll lose my job, so I'm just going to white knuckle it and just be miserable. And I have to say that I understand. There's comfort. A lot of people find comfort in the darkness. They just do. They find comfort in the chaos. You see a lot of people that are in. An analogy would be a bad relationship.
It's just a little bit away from you.
It's better to be in a horrific relationship than to be in no relationship at all.
Wow, that's an interesting. Yeah.
Clinically, that could be a love addict, that could be codependent, whatever. But a lot of people just thrive in the chaos because that's all they know.
Right.
And once you take something that causes the chaos, drugs and alcohol, away, you're missing out. You're bored. You don't know what to do. You know what I mean? What is it? Hello, darkness, my old friend. Is that's it? I mean.
Wow, that's very strong.
And I get attracted to that. I still have an attraction towards that. Like I can be comfortable in that. I can see it. I don't ever go there anymore, but I can see it and I can relate to it 100%.
Wow.
That some people just have been in that darkness for long enough that it's their friend. It's their friend. And it's sad. So white knuckling is in my opinion, no way to live. No way to live.
Well, and then there again, you know, if you brought up the point, you know, where, I have a friend that he grew up with religion. And when I say religion, he grew up in the church, and there's a lot of difference. I've learned, and there's a big difference for people that are seekers. There's many people who have a strong faith within the program, of Alcoholics Anonymous and other programs too, that are staunchly against religion, and yet they consider themselves very spiritual people. And I'm learning how that is.
So, I find that a lot of people, just in my experience, I find a lot of people, when they hear the word spirituality, they immediately go to religion.
Mm.
Religion is spirituality. To be religious and to have faith and to be in that community is spiritual, as far as I'm concerned.
Mm-hmm.
But spirituality is not necessarily religion.
Right.
But it's another stigma. It's another stigma. When people learn about what spirituality really is, they'll have a different opinion. But it seems like right out of the gate, when you ask people about their spiritual program, or you talk about the Big Book, when they talk about the daily reprieve contingent on our spiritual condition, they immediately think church. And it doesn't have to be that way. Hopefully it'll be that way. But it's just one of those arguments, I think, that comes up in quite a few AA books.
You know, the thing about it is, you know, I find that there's probably still a lot of fight in some of the people, and that's okay too. And then there's also the idea of powerlessness, the idea of surrender, the idea, that's the first step. It's a hard step. And yet, turning your life over. We're morphing into our third step, turning your life over to the power of a God and surrendering your will and life over to this power. That's hard to do, even at the point, because people don't want to think that they're not in control of what they're doing. Yet there's times when they really need help, and then they don't know where to turn. And so where I'm going with this, Stephen, is this. For me personally, when I got into recovery, I had to get so myopic about, okay, this is my recovery, you know. And then I realized how important it was to me, this daily reprieve and, one day at a time and stay, be in the moment. And, you know, and then, so I wouldn't work with anybody. And then it hit me. It's only been a few years, maybe even if that, you know, I would not help somebody because I was thinking, well, it's me doing it. But no, it's God doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So God's not going to let me ruin somebody's sobriety.
So that is such, oh God, I think as alcoholics, I'll speak for myself, I make things very, very difficult. And I'm not able to simplify things. Everything is an over. I overthink everything into the ground.
Thank you,
so,
bro.
So when they told me that I needed to turn my will and my life over the care of God as I understood it, and I thought that, so you mean that I could just get in my car and just let go of the wheel and God's going to take me down the road?
Oh,
you know, I mean, you have to make it really, really
yeah.
difficult. You know, and I find, you know, working with other alcoholics, it's a hard thing to understand. You can't just turn it over. I said, well, God gave you a brain. You know what I mean? He gave you the ability to think, you know, but just realize that nothing happens out of chance. So trying to get through that difficult, trying to come into that understanding of turning my will over on every day was not easy. Started going into the third step with realizing that, okay, in the third step, I'm not turning my will over. I'm making the decision to. And that kind of speaks to the same thing where just believe that I believe. And just make the decision, which just these tiny small steps,
yeah.
Opening the door here, opening it a little bit more there. And then once things started getting better, there was the proof. It was the proof that things started getting better. Whether I realized they were getting better or not, they were getting better. You know what I mean? Just going through the motions and believing that other people believed and just staying vigilant. So one day you're just like, oh my God! Yes, mm-hmm. I understand now. Mm-hmm. I understand.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the other point is those of us who, those of us that come from a religious upbringing, that come from a spiritual side of faith. One of the things that we have to do is we've got to come back this way, because one of the in my opinion the things that turn people off of religion is forcing your belief system on somebody else, okay? And so, you know, if you're going to try to evangelize, if you're going to try to witness or testimonium to death, you know, that's not necessarily saying, well, wait a minute, there's a better way. And it just, and it says, in, if you live it, the better way is let God's omnipotence take care of it. Our only path is just to love. And so that's being open to whatever anybody else, the way they find their God. And it's difficult because we get so wrapped up, those of us who are from a religious background, we get wrapped up in what we believe. We have to remember to tell ourselves, wait a minute, let them find that their way.
And I have not had the experience of anybody trying to push anything on me. It's been a slow process for me, and the process continues. It definitely continues. You know, I feel like I have a better understanding daily, slowly, but I believe in something greater than myself, and I couldn't say that 10 years ago. Just
mm-hmm.
couldn't say it. You know, I just couldn't say it. It was coincidence. It was other people. It was, you know what I mean? It was my decision. I had control over my fate. I made the decisions. That's why this happened. So life's completely different right now.
Well, Stephen, do you feel that where you are right now in that, do you feel that that has made a difference in the quality of your sobriety?
100%. I owe it all to that belief. I was blessed with great sponsorship, you know, and they told me that we're not going to talk about drinking. This book is not going to teach you how to stop drinking. It's going to teach you how to find God. This is a design for living. That's what this book is.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And it's a path. It's a path to God. It's a path to something greater than you. We're not, you know, the drink is just a symptom of what of spiritual bankruptcy, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
It's the drink is just a symptom. Now let's learn how to live. And I was blessed with that. And I owe everything to that. My home group this morning, before my home group was fellowship time. I meet with a few guys. We have coffee. Before the meeting every Sunday. And the acceptance came up, you know, and learning to accept. And it just made me think about people people that have come in and out of my life and my sobriety that, you know, were always, anytime I had an issue, love or tolerance, acceptance is the answer to all our problems. You know what I mean? I'd be like, oh, goodness, stop. You know, yeah. But it just came up in our fellowship meeting this morning. And then we get to the meeting and the topic was acceptance.
Yeah.
And this just doesn't happen.
Right.
You know, I don't believe
that. Yeah, I agree.
So it was pretty amazing. But the funny thing was, is that in fellowship in the morning, we both were not, two of us out of the group were not very spiritually fit this morning. I was angry that I didn't have my coffee, you know, that there was people in the line in front of me that weren't acting up to my expectations.
Right.
You know, first problem, don't put expectations on things. You know what I mean? So we had this conversation, we laughed about my spiritual condition was not in a spot where I was able to deal with other human beings this morning. And I need to accept them for who they are. It just worked out perfectly. You could have scripted it any better. And that seems to happen quite a bit. When you have a certain issue and you go to the meeting and the topic is that issue, you're like, wait a second.
Yeah. Well, and you know, the thing about a lot of people in general think, well, I was joking around it with some people at work, you know, saying, you know, that Steve Watts is the new Mr. Rogers, you know. And it's funny because, well, you know, it's not like we just become, you know, Mr. Goody Two Shoes, you know, that we're suddenly transformed into a perfect human being guy, you know, sober man, as my sponsor would say. You know, we're still the same, and it's just the grace that lets us travel, make mistakes, and realize that we're still loved, that we're going to fall down many times, get back up, and yet this time the one thing is that we do it sober though. And we don't fall back on that as a coping mechanism.
And I think we're also looking through a different lens of gratitude. I was never grateful for anything, you know what I mean? So I find myself in a spiritually unfit place. And if I change my lens and look at, okay, I have a roof over my head. I have food in my stomach. I work for a great organization. I've been in a lot worse situations. I know there's a lot of other people in this world right now that are in a lot worse situations than me. So what can I do to get out of myself and help somebody else?
Yeah, you know, that's a wonderful thing you just said. Out of yourself, help somebody else. And the minute you help somebody else, you do something nice for somebody, you're immediately out of yourself. We're going live, Mr. Steven. And you're listening to Conscious Conversations on KUHSDenver.com on Sunday night, April 9th, 2017. And my name is Stephen Ray Watts. I'm so delighted to be here this evening talking about recovery and talking about the benefits of living a sober life. Not only a sober life, but a life of spirituality, a life of spiritual fitness where we walk in the path of a loving God. A God that is full of grace, a God that is ready to meet us wherever we are and just cover us with his peace and love. And all we have to do is accept it. I was talking to another person who at one point they were saying that they didn't understand. They didn't think God wanted anything to do with them. And it's really, from my standpoint, on the contrary, I believe that just given the chance that the Lord is running towards you with open arms. I'm here with my special guest, and we've just had an incredible night of I'm kind of having to reconfigure certain things because we get on a roll on this conversation of both of our experience, strength, and hope, and it's been fantastic. I want to thank you so much for being with me, Stephen.
Thoroughly enjoying it. Thank you.
So I wanted to ask you before, I've got so many things I want to do, and I'm trying, I don't want to be scattered, but I want to talk about one other thing before, as people need help, is the idea, okay, we're backtracking just a little bit. We're going back to, you know, the mental health part of harmony. When people are detoxing and they get clean from their addiction drug, and yet it's just discovered that they need medication to help balance their minds. How do they work that with their sobriety? How do they justify that in themselves that they're sober if they're taking any kind of medicine?
So I think that suffering from mental health issues myself, having a couple inpatient psych stays, I kind of have a behind the front lines view of the mental health field and what they're really trying to do. And there's some amazing people that work back there. Some of the psych nurses and nurse practitioners and psychiatrists and psychologists, I mean, they're truly doing God's work. So today, 2017, the majority of people in recovery are suffering from some kind of mental illness, whether it's just depression, whether it's anxiety, or whether it's something a little bit more severe into the bipolar disorders. So a lot of that goes undiagnosed because we've been self-medicating. So if we don't feel right, whether it's if we're depressed, we drink. If we're happy, we drink. If we have social anxiety, whatever the case is, we're going to lock ourselves in our home and drink. Take that medicine away. The medicine has the substance. You have to be substance free for there to be a proper diagnosis, and that takes a good, solid, well observed, full medical detox. Harmony Foundation has that full medical detox. It's pretty thorough, one of a kind in Northern Colorado. It's pretty serious. I'm excited to offer those types of services. But our detox is a residential evaluation detox. So not only are you detoxing from whatever substance you come to us for, but you're also provided with a mental health evaluation, a thorough mental health evaluation.
That's huge.
So outside of getting a primary counselor and doing some group therapy work at Harmony and getting integrated into the milieu as quickly as possible, your mental health evaluation is going to dictate where you go next through the program at Harmony. Do you need a mental health professional? Do we need to have a psych eval? Do you need to see one of our psychologists? Is medication needed? So it's way above and beyond just a detox only. It's a full mental health evaluation.
Oh, that's fantastic.
So if you look at relapse of people in recovery in their first year, there's a lot of clinical psychologists and other people in the profession that have their top five reasons for relapse.
Right.
And they seem to change every year.
Okay.
In that top three, there's always two consistent reasons for relapse. One being a thorough first step was never done. The second being there was a co-occurring disorder that was undiagnosed and not treated. So if you take away the drugs and alcohol, and there's depression there, and that is not handled,
right,
they're going to self-medicate again. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen. So that mental health piece has to be addressed. Has to be addressed.
Yeah. And that makes total sense. I mean, and it's the idea of being thorough is the chance of increasing the odds of success of sobriety, then in turn increasing the odds of spiritual fitness and happiness and, you know, living a life of joy, you know.
And Bill Wilson talks about his mental health and different medications and whatnot that are necessary. He said that, yes, a lot of people do need to seek help outside of Alcoholics Anonymous. Your sponsor is not qualified to handle your bipolar disorder.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know.
That was a very important thing to hear. Because there's many times that you need to seek outside help, outside the rooms. And that's what your fellowship is for, is people to say, you know, you're feeling this, you need to talk to a professional about that and get some more input on how you're feeling. Has the increase in, I don't know, tell me if I'm saying this right, the opiates, the pills, has this become the worst of our addictions?
So I believe last year, I think 2016, there was 50,000 overdoses of opiates in the United States. Being in the field and in and around the substance abuse world on the East Coast, the majority of clients seeking recovery were in their late teens, early 20s. Primary drug of choice was an opiate. At Harmony Foundation, we're seeing a uptick in opiate-dependent clients, but alcohol has always primarily been the drug of choice. But we're seeing a spike. I mean, it's an epidemic here. Fort Collins, Boulder, Denver, Colorado Springs, the heroin epidemic and the opioid pill epidemic is huge.
Yeah.
So we're starting to see it up there in Estes Park for sure.
Yeah. And then I needed to ask you this part of it also is, and then we'll move on to something I think is really want to get to, is the idea of any kind of maintenance program as far as, you know, I think, you know, the marijuana maintenance. Now, marijuana is a different thing these days. It's not like when I was growing up.
No, it's not.
It's completely it's different. Whole new ball game, and
it's borderline narcotic like.
That's what I was saying.
They are able to breed these strains and cook their marijuana oils down into a potency that is, you know, that these younger people or anybody is smoking into psychosis.
Right.
It's not smoking a joint and getting high anymore. It's serious.
And do you find that as far as with relapse, that you know, the triggers, I mean for one reason or another, people seem to be able to, like, they start their alcohol and they begin to live in a 12-step way of life, and then yet as then they go on, then take a hit of weed.
So they refer to marijuana as the gateway drug.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've heard that before.
That's what I was kind of getting at.
And I think the clinical people refer to it as a cross addiction. Well, you'll meet cocaine addicts or you'll meet alcoholics who say, well, I only do cocaine when I drink.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's because their addiction or they're alcoholics. Marijuana isn't my drug of choice. I'm okay with that. But it always leads them back to the drink.
Yes.
So there is a...
even tobacco.
yeah, exactly. No, exactly. It's coffee always leads me to a cigarette.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same thing. So I took a bartending class a long time ago. I was working at a nightclub up in Vermont. And the alcohol bureau people, the state liquor enforcer people that came to give the course, talked about that. They said that when you introduce alcohol, so a sober person, if you look at it like an equation, like a fraction, a sober person is intellect over emotion. As soon as you add alcohol to the equation, it reverses itself, and it's emotion driving your decisions over your intellect. So if you had any type of willpower not to do any drugs that day and you drank, it's out the window.
Mm-hmm.
There is no intellect there. You are strictly by emotion.
Makes total sense.
Makes sense.
it's blocking, you know, whatever receptors, or, you know, I think about that, and it's so easy to think about it that there is chemical stuff going on.
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, there's the serotonin, there's the dopamine, there's different pleasure chemicals that the brain releases for different drugs, alcohol, cocaine, marijuana, whatever the case is. So if your drug of choice is alcohol and you start doing something else that's feeding the same receptors, it's the same thing, and you're going to go right back to it every time.
You know, and I was talking to our good friend Stephen Wilkins, and he was telling me about some young people that, you know, when we were doing marijuana back in the day, it was you'd get high. And but this has been leading to what they call psychic breaks, mm-hmm. in young people, and it scares them, you know. And when we come back, we're gonna have to wrap up the show. I can't believe how fast this night's gone. I'm gonna do the unthinkable and guilt Steve Latour into coming back sometime. I have so much more I have to cover with him. But we'll get to that when we come back. On Conscious Conversations, KUHSDenver.com.
I can't believe how quickly time is flying right now.
It's such a beautiful thing for me. It's just like, you know, when you're doing something right. You know, it feels good. Yet, I really get a chance to connect with people that are the like-minded thing is very, very amazing. You know, when you said immediately a few minutes ago, you said something that really hit me really hard, Steve. It was like, you know, the idea of, you know, the majority of us that have an addiction problem also have some form of mental illness. And my first thought was, oh, I'm glad it isn't me, you know. Then it just, it went to, oh, he's right. And I don't know what mine is, but I do know that it's there. I had Ben Cort came in.
I love Ben Cort.
Oh, he's a trip. And he's so to the point and so perfectly, brutally honest. You know, we were, I was saying something, I wish I could remember exactly what I was saying. So we were talking sobriety, and we were talking about the whole marijuana thing, and then he just brought it down to a point of basically saying, well, that was your mental illness at that time, and I'm like, oh gosh, okay.
So a good friend of mine, I have a long psych story, but the long and short of it is, I quit smoking cigarettes 2 years ago, and it was probably the hardest thing I've ever had to do. Was quit smoking cigarettes, but I still chew nicotine gum. And a friend of mine said, he goes, who's to say that God did not put nicotine in this world to be your antidepressant?
Really? Yeah.
You know what I mean? Who's to say that nicotine is not your antidepressant? You know what I mean? And it makes sense to me because for a number of different reasons. But, you know, at the same time, I mean, mental illness does not mean that you need to be on medication. You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, just your spiritual condition and your spiritual connection and certain things that you practice every day can help you maintain anxiety. It can help you maintain different levels of all types of mental illness. When we hear mental illness, we think of straitjacket and rubber. That's what we think.
You're
of.
Right. You're right. Definitely. No doubt about it.
So I was, my last detox was in a psych hospital in New Hampshire, and they wanted me to be certain mental illnesses so bad. You know, they were just like, you have to be this, you have to be that, you must be this. I said, no, I'm just an alcoholic who likes heroin. And these are why I have these ups and downs. And, you know, there was a time in my life where I did a lot of cocaine, so there was a lot of highs there. And then there was a time when I did a lot of downers and a lot of heroin, there's a lot of lows there. That doesn't mean I'm bipolar. That means that I liked different substances at different times during my life. But they had me convinced that I was borderline personality disorder, bipolar 1. That was my diagnosis. Mm-hmm. I wasn't even sober yet. I mean, I was still detoxing, withdrawing from a number of different chemicals. Yeah. And so they started trying all these different medications.
Oh, goodness gracious, Steve.
It was rough.
Oh, my goodness.
So finally, so they leveled me out on whatever after being a guinea pig for a little while. They were trying to help me.
Right.
I'm not going to knock them. They were really trying to help me, but I think that they were taking shots in the dark. So I ended up settling on a certain amount of medications, and I ended up staying on them for about 6 months under orders from my sister that she would never speak to me again if I stopped taking these medications.
Oh, boy.
And I love my younger sister. Right. She saved my hiney more than once. So eventually, under doctor's supervision, I weaned myself off of the medications, and I haven't been on anything since. You know what I mean? But it probably kept my mood stable and whatever. It probably helped me in early sobriety.
Yeah.
As long as I, you know.
Well, and you know, I
remember. Some type of routine.
Sure.
You know?
Sure. Well, you know that we go back to this idea of what we consider mental health, and we're human. I mean, we're built up with emotions. We're built with different physiological and chemical situations. You know, there are people that need to work out, mm-hmm. and they need that workout to get those endorphins. They don't get those endorphins. So that's their medication. There's other instances that I can think of, you know, that people need this in order to function, mm-hmm. you know. And so like depression, even sunshine, you know, I think sunshine, you know, vitamin D, sunshine for people live in a place where it's cloudy all the time. That affects your mental.
I don't remember what they refer to, the lack of sunshine disorder. But people that work nights, that have worked days, most of the time work nights, will go into a depression.
Yeah.
Your internal clock's a mess, and chemicals aren't being produced when they're supposed to be. And we're delicate. Mm-hmm. We're delicate. The smallest change can really throw us off of our game.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think it's refreshing to be able to look at that and look at it with, like you say, through new glasses and see something for what it is and really understand it, you know, that argument has gone around the rooms very, very, it gets heated, you know, people that are, they say, some people have said, if you're on meds, you're not sober. And I'm
right,
going,
right.
Oh, wait a minute.
Right. Oh, Bill Wilson didn't say that.
Yeah, don't go there. You know, it's not.
So that's a great segue, or at least a great. I guess the new conversation in the substance abuse treatment world is medication assisted therapy, or medication assisted treatment, which would be Subutex or Suboxone for opiate addicts. Where they're on some type of medication for longer than detox, you know, like a 30-day, a 60-day, a one-year-long taper off of medication.
Wow.
It's being harder. It's harder for them to integrate into the 12-step community because of that stigma. People, well, you're not sober. You can't have a spiritual experience if you're on this. It's like, really? Okay. All right. So, but at the same time, it's like, you know what? It's nobody's business if you're on it.
I agree.
It's nobody's business if you're on a long opiate medication taper. It's nobody's business. And as a member of Alcoholics Anonymous, and as somebody who is a satisfied customer, I guess, I'm not going to close the door on somebody seeking help.
Mm-mm.
I'm not going to not allow you to do some step work because you're on a medication.
Absolutely.
No, I mean, if your medication is Budweiser, then I understand. You know what I mean? If you're smoking.
But there's a big difference, difference, like you say.
If you're under a doctor's care going through something and it's not being abused and it's part of something with abstinence being the goal, then we can start the work right now.
Mm-hmm.
You're not allowed in the treehouse. You know what I mean? But I understand. I think a lot of the old timers, you know, I mean, I consider myself a drug addict just as much as I do an alcoholic. But it was very easy for me. Well, I found my recovery in AA.
Mm-hmm.
So if it was just me just calling myself an alcoholic and not talking about drugs, I was okay with that because I knew that all the old timers in my particular men's group and so forth,
right.
they were all drug addicts,
yeah.
but we just referred to ourselves as alcoholics mm-hmm. and that's all we talked about. That's fine.
That's fine.
Because I had a problem with alcohol. It was easy for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been an incredibly enlightening. I'm going to, can you do It's about 5 till midnight. Can you do another 10-minute segment, and then we'll say good night. I'll walk you to the door after that. And
perfect.
And I'll just spring it on you. It's not anything big, but you'll know what I'm talking about. And it has to do with what we were kind of talking about just now. Okay, we're going live, Stephen. And I am so grateful to have Mr. Stephen Latour, who is involved with business development at Harmony Foundation in Estes Park. It's been an incredible evening of discussion and conversation, experience and strength and hope, as we like to say in our field. I am so grateful for Stephen taking the time out on a late night, last hour Sunday night. I wanted to talk about how people get help, and they can go to HarmonyFoundationInc.com mm-hmm. and find out, and they can check out how do you get that person to make the call for their loved one, or how do you get that person to call for themselves?
That's a really, really good question. Reaching out to somebody like myself in business development, we like to kind of be a liaison sometimes before you actually make the call.
Mm-hmm.
So our admissions people are not order takers. If that makes sense.
Right. No,
they're
it does.
Not there to assume that you're coming into treatment.
Or to upsell.
Right, exactly. So part of the reason that I joined the Harmony Foundation team was I knew that they don't market themselves as the cure. And they are happy with being part of a plan.
Mm.
So calling Harmony, we might not be a fit for you. And we're not ever going to say that we're something that we're not.
Mm-hmm.
So at the very least, Harmony is going to hold your hand and find the help that you need at an appropriate facility if you're not a fit for us.
Wow.
So admissions is not, they're not, okay, what's your name? What insurance policy do you have? How long have you been drinking? It's, let's start from the beginning.
And yeah.
Let's find out exactly what you're seeking. A little bit of a motivational interview, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to make sure that you get somewhere or at least understand what level of care might be appropriate for you. But just like walking into your first AA meeting or the first time that you actually surrender to a friend or a family member and say, I have a problem, that phone is heavy. It's a heavy thing to pick up, but realize that nobody's pushing you into anything. And that is why I am making Harmony Foundation my home, because of the friendly, supporting, altruistic mission behind the Harmony Foundation. I mean, we're not there to, it's not about heads in beds, so to speak.
It's
we haven't been up there for 48 years by doing that.
Well, you know, and just the way you describe that, when a person calls and they have somebody talk to them and talk to them on a human level first, you know, rather than saying, well, here's what you need to do. It's no, how are you? What's up? I mean, and getting talked to as, okay, you're a human being and you're hurting, or so you know somebody who is. That's got to be one of the hardest calls for anybody to make for a loved one.
And not only personally, but if you look at the treatment center substance abuse industry as a whole and what you find on the internet and the silver-tongued salespeople and the you'll come here and ride horses on the beach and that the internet is a black hole. And unfortunately that gives even reputable facilities in the industry a bad name.
Mm-hmm.
And that conversation can be tough because you're expecting the worst.
Mm-hmm.
You're expecting to be, you've probably been lied to already before, you know, or you find that it's really all just about your insurance policy, not about you.
Right.
And what we can do for you. And unfortunately, that's a battle we have to fight, you know, but that's why, you know, in my position as business development, which is also another word for community outreach,
mm-hmm.
or I can be that middle person and sit down and talk to the family about what treatment looks like.
Well, and I find that incredibly refreshing because, you know, don't you know, Steve, I'm going to quit tomorrow. Tomorrow's the day.
Mm.
I'm going to quit tomorrow. I can do this, you know. And then it was the next day. And then it was the next day because it was an odd day. It was the 15th. That's
right.
A good day. It's the middle of the month. It's the 15th. Then it was St. Patrick's Day. That's the perfect day to quit drinking. And these days were every day, all year long for me.
So time is of the essence. Most of the time, there's a really short window when people are willing. And that's why, really good interventionists like Stephen Wilkins, they know what that window is and they act.
Right.
If you're dealing with somebody, if you're dealing with a loved one who agrees to go to treatment, and that doesn't happen within the first 20, in the next 24 hours, their next line to you is, well, I've stayed sober for 24 hours. I don't need to go to treatment. I'm doing
yes. Yes.
You know, that window is so small.
That, and, you know, I can remember literally the moment of clarity that I had. My wife helped me with this, and it's a very sensitive thing. And yet it was that moment of clarity was just that creak in the door that you talked about that mm-hmm. that I let down enough to say, okay, it's got to change. And people can find help at Harmony Foundation. You can find help. You can find people who care. And this is so important. You can find not only, analysis of the addiction and the problem and help get properly detoxed, because you have to remember, I get reminded when I went up to Harmony, I was reminded that withdrawal from alcohol can be fatal.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I didn't even know that, Stephen.
Yeah. Alcohol is one of the most dangerous detoxes.
Yeah.
They need to be observed. There's risk of seizure. You need full observation. It used to just be emergency room detox only, but luckily, Harmony's Health Center is just so technologically advanced and well-staffed. Our medical doctor, who is full-time on staff on campus, is an addictionologist, which is very rare in the MD world. You'd be surprised at how little addiction and substance abuse the doctors actually get throughout
yeah.
the education.
Yeah.
It's mind-blowing.
Yeah, and it's true, and I can feel their frustration.
Yeah.
There from the standpoint of a body that has been, as we say, badly burned by drugs and alcohol. You know, I talked to a couple of the nurses up there, and you know, I told them what we do with the show here, talking about recovery and when I went up there to speak with people, and they thanked me, and I said, oh my gosh. You're the ones on the front lines.
Front lines is right.
Oh my goodness. And they're the ones that see the real ugliness that can be there. But what I want to stress before we say goodnight is that, you know what? A phone call or jumping online, little research isn't going to hurt anybody.
Uh-huh.
And if you think you have a loved one that needs help, you know, just do the research. You know, and suggest and or self. If you think you have a problem yourself, you know, do the research, make a call, just talk to somebody, talk to another person and get their point of view. That's not going to hurt. Well, Stephen Latour, thank you so much for coming in tonight.
Thank
and
you,
being
Steve.
My special guest, this
Glad
has been
here.
A God, it's been fun.
I hope we can do this again soon.
I already guilted you into doing it again, so
I'll have to
give you a call when you've had a chance to reflect and see if it's something you enjoyed. But I'd love to have you back. It's been a phenomenal evening. Thank you for coming and doing the show. But even more, I thank you for the work that you do, and I thank you for your honesty and for sharing your story. It's an incredible story, and that's not, you know, we tend to do that because it's part of, you know, it's one of the hard parts of recovery, saying we don't want to close the door on the past because we know that our past can help somebody.
Right. Yeah. My grand sponsor says we're uniquely qualified.
We are. Well, I'm going to walk Mr. Stephen Latour to the door and say goodnight to him, but thank you. We're going to sign off on Conscious Conversations when I get back. Right now, this is Deja Vre by Dot Zero. Okay. We're clear on radio.
I can't believe how quickly that went. Seriously.
It's freaky to me. You know, it's, and ever since I started doing it, it's just kind of been that way. But I have something for you.
Oh, wow.
And I've got your official.
Oh, look at that.
Your official Conscious Conversation mugs. And my little hobby is God Rocks.
Oh, wow.
And then here's our latest.
Oh, excellent.
So,
well, thank you very much.
You're very welcome. I'm so happy that you could make it
amazing.
Tonight.
It was amazing.
And
way beyond expectations, for sure.
Well, good.
I had no idea what to expect, and that was just fantastic.
Well, I sure appreciate you know, your honesty and just I feel like, you know, I always love talking to people that I connect with, you know. So cool.
So cool. All right.
Well, I hope to stay in touch. I'm gonna try to get up there. I've got a Saturday night coming up. Then I'm gonna be off. Thank you. Okay, well, I'm back, and we're going to sign off on radio, and then we're going to sign off on the stream. So, which we need to do. Really excited to have Stephen Latour in from Harmony Foundation. How blessed am I? How blessed are we to have so many guests and to grace this studio from Harmony Foundation, all with the same mission of helping people find the solution, find recovery and find sobriety. Most importantly, find God, find their loving God that will run towards them with open arms and embrace them with His grace, exactly where they are, right where they are. That to me is incredible. Hallelujah. Okay, we're going to sign off on Conscious Conversations. Sign off to Germany, Indonesia, Mexico, Spain, Istanbul, Turkey, Trabuca, Canyon, United States, India, Munich, Germany, Romania, Italy. Well, I need to sign off on Conscious Conversations on show number 57 right here at KUHSDenver.com. I'm going to kind of move a little bit fast tonight because I have a lot of prayers to talk about. So I'd like to thank Mr. Stephen Latour from Harmony Foundation for being my special guest tonight. What an awesome, awesome conversation we had together. A real connection. I feel that we are definitely kindred spirits, and he brought out some things that I had never thought about, much less heard before. So I thank you for that incredible input and fresh insight into Conscious Conversations, Stephen. Next week on Conscious Conversations, oh man, am I excited. It's Easter Sunday. How could you not be excited? He is risen. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. And He has overcome the power of death and sin. And He has the power to give you eternal life if you believe on His name is all. I'd like to shout out to my soulmate, Sandra. I love you with all my heart, Sandra. Send prayer requests to me. We're asking for worldwide prayer for Tina battling cancer. Also, Roz, whose cancer has returned, hope that the return of remission is possible for her as soon as possible. Also, all those suffering from cancer and other debilitating health issues, including Ronnie and so many others, the healing presence of Jesus Christ. Also, people battling substance use disorder, Stevie, a young lady battling addiction, as well as Adam, and Gabriel, and Connie, Tim, Zach, Bruce, and David. Monty and Stacy need your prayers as well. Strength to endure consequences of substance abuse and courage to begin sobriety fresh. Consequences both medically and also legally. Young lady named Z needs your prayer for her current home and family situation. Pray that she can find the help she needs and find strength, and hold her hand out to a higher power. Hold her hand out to God. My friend Michael M. is still recovering and working on healing so he can get back to the things that he loves to do and get back home. I pray for Michael M. and his healing and relief from pain. My friend Ray needs prayer as well for continued healing and strength to endure and persevere. He's a strong man, and he's been tested, but he's endured, and he's stayed the course in the belief of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Fellow musician needs prayer, Andrew, but I heard he's made progress, and he might even be home. And if that is the case, that is the power of prayer. That is the power of God's healing grace, God's healing power through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Prayers go out to Keely also, who lost her brother and is dealing with the pain and confusion of that. Katrina, also in Kansas, and Michaela in Texas needs prayer as well. Please remember that I pray better than I play, and I actually like to pray more than I like to play. Next week, where is Dotsero? Well, we're at Live at Jack's. That's right. It's a whole new name, Live at Jack's, on April the 14th. Let's see. I think that's right. I'm even going to look. April the 14th. We've got the early show at Live at Jack's, 5 p.m. And Saturday the 15th at Live at Jack's, 9 p.m. Words to ponder. Here's our benediction for tonight. Benediction is Romans 15. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Remember, that is the Holy Spirit that God, that Jesus Christ gave us to live inside of us, so that we may be his forever. And in the words of Charles Dickens, from his famous story that is, in many ways, my own story, a story of redemption and reclamation, God bless us, everyone. For Conscious Conversations, I'm Stephen Ray Watts. Good night. And to close off on the stream, it is my prayer tonight that you reach out to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Ask him to be with you, to stay present with you, and to fill you with his Holy Spirit. It's my joy in life to proclaim, to boldly proclaim his living word, his will, his way in his time, and to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're going to celebrate Easter next week. He is risen. My Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is risen indeed, and he is living and risen from the dead. He will come again and rule all who believe in his name. I can't wait for next week because it is Easter, and I've got some great plans for this show. I'm going to spend all week working on it. I hope you have a safe, joyful, and glorious, blessed week. Take care of yourself, your families. Try to help someone else. And smile. Try to fill yourself with His joy. Amen.